they should provide Abu Dhabi with the permission of Hashem. I will get to tell you one beautiful story about Hannah Bishivai Ladea. You know, in Tisha B'Av, we mourn the death of Hannah and her seven children.
Yeah.
And the story happened when the king of Greece, he wanted that Hannah, she was a beautiful woman, and she lost her husband, maybe he was killed, and she had seven children. And those seven children, they were educated as a good Jew. So the king, he wanted to try to influence the children to become Greek, so that it would be for him a big honor that the children now they left the Jewish religion. Then he thought maybe he will marry the mother, Hannah. But Hannah, she educated so well the children, so the children, they were so educated in the Jewish religion, they loved so much Hashem, that no way that the king of Greece, he could convince them to change their religion. And every time he warned them, he threatened them, do this, eat a ham, do Avodah Zarah. And each time that one of them refused, he killed him. You know, cruelly killed him in front of everybody, in front of the brothers. He wanted to frighten the brothers. And each time the brothers, before they died, they saw the mother. The last baby was a baby. The mother, she feed him before he started to talk to the king. He was a baby. And the king of Greece, he talked to the baby, baby, I give you chocolate, I give you sweets, I will give you games, I give you a bath, I give you, I give you Nintendo to play games. No, do me a favor. It will be the sandwich. The baby said, you think you want to buy me with all this? I'm Jew. I remain Jew, and I will die as a Jew. No way. And he started to curse the king. You nothing. You think to buy people with money. The king couldn't resist. He took the baby and he killed him. Well, the mother, she saw that. She was afraid that the baby will rape her. You know, she was a woman, of course. She knew that the Greek people, they will not let her just alive like that. They will make her suffer, they will kill her, maybe they will rape her, and then they will kill her. What she did, she threw herself from the roof. But before she died, I forgot to tell you something, but before the baby, they killed him, she told him, my son, when you reach Olam Haba, you go up there, tell Abraham Avinu that I am more than him. He sacrificed one baby, I sacrificed seven. Just go and tell him. Now, after she passed away, now, there is two questions. First question, why Hannah, she did not wine till she died, and she would tell Abraham Avinu, you sacrifice wine, I sacrifice seven. Why she have to tell this to the baby? First question. Second question, the second question, I heard it from Moshe, my son. He Moshe Israeli heard it from somebody. So the question is it a game? Are we talking about a game that we play a goal? I shoot 7 goals, you shoot 1 goal. What does that mean? I sacrifice 7. Are you with me? And you sacrifice 1. What does that mean? I sacrifice 7 children. You sacrifice 1. I mean, this is not a game. What the meaning of this? Allah Baba is Allah Baba. I mean, I know somebody, the Rebbe of Tzatz, Alav HaShalom, Rabbi Kutiel, Rabbi Yehuda Kutiel, the Nazis killed 11 of his children, and he killed his wife. Can you imagine that he will say to Hashem, Hashem, tell Avraham Avinu, he lost 1, he sacrificed 1, I sacrificed 12. And I want to tell you something. During the Shoah, there were some Hasidim people that they had 22, 23, 24 children. They were big family. And they all died for Hashem. Would those people will say to Hashem, hey, Hashem, tell Abraham, he sacrificed 1, I sacrificed 22, 23 children. That's not a game. So why? What does that mean? Hannah, she's telling to her child, tell Abraham, you Abraham, you sacrifice 1. My mother told me to tell you, you sacrifice 1, I sacrifice 7. What does that mean? And besides this, my question is why Hannah, she would not wait to tell that to Abraham. She knows that she's going to throw herself from the roof. So she would tell Abraham, why she have to tell the baby? I was thinking this last night, yesterday morning. It's a beautiful story. And you know, from stories, you learn things. From stories, you learn a lot of things. I always learn from stories. You know, sometimes I was watching a small video how birds that they live in the desert, when they have baby birds, they make the baby bird on the top of the mountain. Why? Because there is no fox. But there is a lot of fox, there is no fox. But on the top of the mountain, there is about 150 meters down. So when the baby reach the time that he has to fly, he has 150 meters to fly, and he should fly to the water. And he should fly to the water. If he don't fly to the water, and if he fail, there is the fox, they will eat him. So you see the fox are waiting for those birds when they fly, because that small is the first time that they fly. So they have to fly, really, they must fly. I mean, they must fly to the water they are safe. But if they fail, it's finished for them. And you know what you see? You see sometimes the mother, she pushed the baby to fly, and the baby fail. And you see the fox, you know, the fox, they come to eat it. So what the mother does for the other child, for the other girl, you know what you need? She push him and she fly with him. And she fly below him. She direct him to follow her. You understand? And then if he does follow her well, he fell in the water. But if he is crazy, he does follow her well, he fell in the floor. Then what happened? The fox will come and eat it. This is a beautiful story, but you know, it's something that you see. For me, from that, I learned something. I learned even animals, they educate the children. Even animals, Hashem give to the animals sechel, clarity, intelligence, to teach them where is the danger, how to fly, when you have to fly, and when you start flying, how to fly in a way that you will not die, that you will remain alive, but you have to follow the mother. Abraham, Yitzhak, Yaakov, they teach us the way how to live. Abraham was the chesed. What does mean chesed? Chesed, that means you have to do good things, you have to be honest, good to all other people. You know, Abraham Avinu, he used to give all what he had, and he had to, and a lot of times he had to borrow money to do charity. And always he relied on Hashem, that Hashem will help him. And always we saw the house of Abraham Avinu open. Sarah, she welcomed everybody. And we saw that a lot of people, they comfort themselves because they saw the kindness of Abraham Avinu. They never saw somebody like Abraham. So we learned from Abraham Avinu, Hesed. And that for generations. If you see today, Am Israel, they do charities. Am Israel, they do Chesed. Am Israel, they do they do a lot of sacrifice because they learned that from Abraham. Abraham for us was an example. Bechilach be'et be'atzon. You know, if you don't want to get lost in the desert, you follow where the people were. You follow the road. There is a route. A lot of people, they want to try to take a new route. If you want to try to take a new route, you will get lost. If there is a route that it's for everybody, follow the normal route. Look, today, we have a route. Our route today is the route that Abraham and Yaakov teach us. We followed it. But if you want to follow new rabbis, new people, new route, you get lost. Even business, if your business is going well, don't change it. A lot of people want to change business. I tell them, why you change? Hey, Baruch Hashem, you know, you go to your business, you need to do well, and Baruch Hashem, you build up an empire in this business. Why you want to change to the other business? Who said that the new business, it will be a success for you? Maybe you will lose everything. They met a lot of people, they lost everything because they were crazy. They wanted to do something else. Leave, hey, remain in your business and try another one if you want. But don't stop this one to try a new one. Yeah, no guarantee. We have the way that the Abraham is hardly Yaakov. Is not chassé, how you say that?
They made a path.
They made as a route. That we have to follow it. Look, so. When there is snow, and you don't know where to go, do you see some marks on the snow? What do you do? You follow the maps. Maybe they will lead you to somewhere. So especially you see a lot of marks. So why you have to take a new one? Take this one. There is a majority of people took it. So from Abraham Avinu we learn something. From Yitzhak Avinu we learn Avodat Hashem. From Yitzhak Avinu we learn sacrifice. And Avodat Hashem is Avodat Hashem. Business is business. Avodat Hashem is Avodat Hashem. How to serve Hashem? We sacrifice. From Abraham Avinu, we learn exile. Even in exile, Abraham Avinu learned that tzaddik. When he went to Haran for 22 years with Laban, he was a big Rasha Alaban, Yaakov learned that tzaddik. And he was a man of Torah. So Baruch Hashem, we learned from Yaakov Avinu, we can be in Canada, we can be a good Jew, we can be in America, we can be in Morocco, we can be wherever we are in exile, we can be good Jews. And we learned this from who? From Yaakov Avinu. So now you understand Hannah. Hannah, she has shalom. She don't want to play games with Abraham Avinu. You shot one goal, I shoot seven goals, and I won. No, she wants to tell him, Abraham, we follow his steps. Because if you would not sacrifice his heart, I would not sacrifice my seven children. And if I had a success, that I sacrificed seven children, it's because of you. Because you give us the derech. And that, you understand me, Meir, that was a lesson for all Jews. All Jews, they learned something. What all Jews learned? All Jews learned. Because it was in a time of the Greek, they would do bad things in Eretz Israel. They would kill Jews. They would push Jews to change their religion. So Hannah, she wanted to show everybody how strong everybody should be. Look at me. I sacrificed my seven children. Why? Because I followed the steps of Abraham Avinu. I followed the steps of Yitzhak Avinu. I followed the steps of Yaakov Avinu. So do like me. It's not Has V'Shalom. That Hannah, she wanted to argue that I am more than you. No, I am more than Abraham Avinu. No, she just wanted to send a message that if it was not Abraham Avinu, that he was the first one to sacrifice himself, I will not be able to do what I'm doing. And besides this, there's another message here, that the seven children, no one of them is converted no one of them changed his religion. Why? Because of the education. Like Abraham Avinu, the way he educated, it's hard. Just listen to this. It's hard. He was 34 years old. He was not a baby, it's hard. At the time that Abraham told him, Hashem wanted to sacrifice you, he could tell him no. Abraham was an old man. He could tell him no, I don't want. You sacrifice yourself. Sacrifice Ishmael. Sacrifice Eliezer. Sacrifice one of your children, one of your students, why me? But it's hard. He did not say no. Why? Because Abraham is sacrificed. Abraham educated Yitzhak Avinu to love Hashem, that for any reason that could happen, it's hard. He would never say no to Hashem. So Rachel, Hannah, she said to the child, tell Abraham that the same way you, Abraham, educated, it's hard until he accepted to sacrifice himself. Even all my children, they sacrificed themselves. So for me, you, Abraham, you were the leader. I learned from you. That was a message. I have to tell you something. When, before Mashiach will come, we'll see a lot of people living the religion. We need some. You know, this week, listen to this, Mayor. This week, there is a rabbi here in Canada, Montreal. He has a beautiful voice. He sings. Mm-hmm. I forgot his name. Always when I come here, he comes to see me. He's a big husband of the family. And last year, I gave a show in the college here in Montreal, and then it was the day of Tisha B'Av. And the show that I was, I gave a show about the, God forbid, Has V'Shalom, the danger that there is in the internet, and danger if you don't use it for the good purpose, understand? If you don't use it for the good purpose, the danger that there is on those electronic machines. And then, the story, that was my show. Friday evening, Erev Shabbos, he came and he gave me a big kiss, and he told me, Rabbi David, you cannot know the impact that it did for me, what you've been talking last year about all this. I went home, I said to my wife, you were the first one to give that to the house, and now I am the one who wants to throw it out of my house because I cannot serve Hashem with this. because I see bad things. And it's not good for me. And if it's not good for me, maybe one day we'll divorce. Because I am a weak man. I have too much tzara. I can't. The only way I have to do, like Rabbi David said. So he was a strong man. So he took it and he broke it. He took his telephone, iPhone, he broke it. I said, now what you have? He said, now I have a telephone, but it's kosher. I have nothing inside because it's hard for me.
I have a BlackBerry.
No, you know, he said, it's hard for me. And he said, so, he did. Excuse me to tell you, there is a rabbi here in Montreal, unfortunately. There is two or three people very, very well known, unfortunately. One Toronto, two here, Montreal. They did divorce because of this. Unfortunately. You know, Baruch Hashem. There is people that they are intelligent. They use it for the good things.
Yeah.
But there is people that they are weak. They are not intelligent. They can, they can, you know, in France, you know, in France, they start to understand that the French government is start to reduce. Now we put some control. What it should be there, what it should not be there. Somebody from Facebook, he collects money from my name. He opened something on Facebook, put my picture there,
yeah.
And he put all my shiori, and he collect money. Yeah. He said it's me who collect money. Moshe, he stopped him this week. You see, we live in a world that it's crazy. Crazy world. I could believe it. It's not a, just to tell you, sacrifice. I mean, can you imagine somebody who loves something and then he decided to stop? He said it's Baal Tshuva. What is a Baal Tshuva? Baal Tshuva is somebody that was a Rasha and he decided to do Tshuva. He decided to stop. It's a big sacrifice, you know that. To stop, it's a sacrifice. It's not easy to stop. So Rahel is Hannah the Tzaddiket. She wanted just to tell Abraham, Avino, Abraham. And she said to her baby, tell Abraham that if I did what I did, it's only because of you. Because you were the first one to teach us Nefesh, to do sacrifice for Hashem. So I followed your steps. And that was a message for everybody. Everybody heard what Hannah did. So everybody took a big musar, a big encouragement. So what Hannah, now the question is, why Hannah, she did not wait till she arrived there, and she will saw Abraham, and she will tell him, her threat was, maybe she will not die. So if she will not die, who's going to give the message to Abraham? She was afraid. Maybe I will, at least, if I die, I will repeat it. But for the moment, maybe for the moment, the baby will die. But just look at it. The way she gives the education to the children, even the baby was a tzaddik. Even the baby, he would not change his God for somebody else. Why? The kind of the education that he received from the mother. How much to love Hashem, not to change Hashem for no one. Of no one. You understand? Now, I would like to tell you this. This story, Hannah, Mishivayel, Banea. Hannah, the history of Hannah and the seven children. Why? Maybe there is a message here. Why seven? The number of seven. It means something.
Sure.
It means something, the numbers of seven. were thinking that seventh mean the sixth day that Hashem created the world. The seventh is Shabbos. How much a man and the sixth day is the 6,000 years that the world will remain till Mashiach will come. Mashiach will come at the end of the 6,000 years, the beginning of the 7,000, that it will be Shabbat. When Mashiach will come, as Hashem, it will be Shabbat. It will be the Olam, will be the world, will be corrected. The world will be corrected, will be finished. And during the 6,000 years, how much you have to work hard. And before Mashiach will come, it will be a disaster. It will be like this baby, you know, a baby is very weak in his mind. Understand me? A baby is very weak. A baby can throw himself out of the window because a baby don't see danger. A baby can cross the street. He can cross the auto road. He don't feel the danger. The baby. And we put a bottle of coca. If we think it's coca, maybe it is there. Maybe it's not coca. Maybe it's a baby. What any family want to eat it? The baby don't see danger. Before Mashiach will come, there will be so much temptations in the world. There will be so much Yitzhara. We will be inside the Yitzhara until we will not realize the danger of everything. So, we need to go.
For sure.
This is the only way, good education. Torah. Only that can protect you. And I think this is the meaning of the Chana v'shiva avaleha. Chana represents Hashem, represents the Torah. V'shiva avaleha, that means the 7 days week. How much we have to support them, to live them with their Hashem. So Be'ez Hashem, when Mashiach will come, we tell Abraham, thank you Abraham, thank you Yitzhak, thank you Yaakov, the way you direct us, the way you teach us to live, that was the way I will live. And this is, my friend, Be'ez Hashem. Of course, people today are talking very, they say, well, it's a long road. It's a long exile. What's going to happen? Why? But you have to know one thing. Baruch Hashem, there's going to be something better. You know, I saw somebody was destroying his house. He has a beautiful villa somewhere in Los Angeles. It was a beautiful house, a $6-7 million house. And then he told Rabbi David, I want you to come to give me the bracha for the new house that I want to build. But I said, but it's a new house last week. It's in there. And he said, I want to build a better one. I said, but you don't feel bad that you're going to destroy a beautiful house? He said, yes, I know. I feel bad. But Rabbi David, I have to tell you, if you see the new plan, 10 times more nicer than what you saw. Okay, did not. It's his business, but it doesn't mean I agree with him. I don't agree with him, but it's his business. What can I tell you? If you want to do it, I can't stop him. But anyway, this is exactly the mashal, the example for Hashem. Hashem destroyed the first Beit HaMikdash. It was beautiful. Hashem destroyed the second Beit HaMikdash. It was beautiful. But we're waiting for the third one. That's what God is nicer. That's what the Babitzer of Rebbe, Babitzer Hakali Weber, he said. He said, Beseder, okay, we are very sad today, but because we are in exile, we are very sad because of all what we live through. But where's the shame? There is a consolation. What? We can have a bit of the Mikdash. We can have a bit of it. So to live Be'ezat Hashem, to have the zichut, to see the first bit of Mikdash, you have to follow the steps of Abraham and Yitzhak Yaakov. And Mecca, you know, the Gemara will say, before Mashiach will come, it's going to be hard to be a Jew. I remember when I was a baby, an Arabic used to say, Abiyah Dehda or Abiyah Demahdas. It's an Arabic. It's like an impression of good to leave Mashiach. It's better not to leave Mashiach. Good to leave Mashiach because we see all the miracles that Hashem is going to do if Mashiach will come. Lord, there is a lot of money, a lot of signs that we saw today. And there is another, the Maharal said, better not to see Mashiach because it's going to be so much itzara, big itzara, maybe you will lose your Judaism. But maybe not. If you are stronger, maybe you will not lose your Judaism. You will live more your Judaism. It's going to be, maybe today we live. We live today a generation of money. And people are stealing the money from other people. Very much. Testing, just all what they think about, make money, 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 money. This is the biggest Avodah Zarah today. Money, 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 money. You say they are, okay, money is good. But at least make it, earn it, honestly, be honest, not stealing money, and do good things with it. Like Abraham, Isaac, Yaakov, they were billionaires, Abraham, Isaac, but they did good things with it. They did good things with it. So I think from the history that you learn, from Hannah, that we had 7 children, with a big king, that the king he wanted to give them the whole world, just if they listen to his voice, if they listen to their desire, and they prefer to die for Hashem, not to follow his desire. And that was the message that Hannah wanted to give to all Jews, all mothers, all parents, educate well your children, so your children will be all the time connected only to Hashem. I want you to tell you something, my friend. We're talking about a king that he killed 7 children. Let's say he would not kill them. Just today, we're not talking about killing. Today we're talking about killing spiritually. If a mother don't give good Jewish education to the children, they will die spiritually. They will live. Physically, they will live. But spiritually, they're dead. And there is a big tzara. The tzara, Benet, yesterday, there was a father and mother, they were picking their son. They have a son, 30-year-old son, take drugs. He drink. Don't pray. And they promise him a big amount of money just if he can come to me to get the bracha. You know he was sitting in front of me with the arrogance, with the chutzpah. The parents were tzaddikim, and he was sitting, yes, with the bracha. The parents said, Abi David, if you can give me a bracha. I don't need a bracha. He answered, I'm okay like that. I'm happy. Oh, and the parents started to talk. You don't want to pray. Why do you have to pray? To pray to whom? I have everything. And if I don't have, I can get. He was talking with a bit arrogance. Now, who do you abuse? The parent. Because the parent, you don't give no kosher, no Shabbat, nothing. They live like everybody. So they make a baby that he was a, like a behemoth, like a. Now they regret, but it's too late now. Today we live the generation, the worst generation of all generations. I saw one day in the paper, there was a statistic. There were never been divorced like our generation. In all world, Jew, not Jew, divorce. And there was no people now, young people, believe on their own. Never we saw people living on their own, all with the parents till they get married. Today, people are living alone because they want to be free. Freedom. There is a man that I saw in Paris. He has 7 children. None of them is married. Everybody lives in a house. Even the one, the last one, is 17-year-old. He asked his father, I want to get a flat. I don't want to live with you. 17-year-old. He wants to live in his own. People, they want to be free. Now, you see why there is too much houses. There's too much houses. Before you should see a city, only you could not understand. Like Isawira, they were there at the time, I remember, 50,000 people living in Isawira, but the city was small. You know why? Because in each house there is a big family. Today, the city is larger, bigger. Why? Because people they live in their own. So everyone was happy, want a house. So now you need, like Paris. Paris, if you reduce all the people that live in their own, you have only one half of Paris. You will have only half, even Montreal. You will have half of Montreal if everyone go to his parents. And if there is no divorce. You have a divorce, so a man, the husband, one house, the woman, one house, the children, each one on the house. You need a lot of houses, education. Education, that is the message of Hannah. Hannah, the message of Hannah is, when 7,000 came, at the end of the 6,000 year, when the Mashiach will come, it's going to be the biggest disaster. The people that will have the brain like a baby. But if this baby is well educated, he will not leave Hashem. Like he's the baby of Hannah. Even that he was feeding, he was a baby, he did not live his Judaism. He remained Jew and he died Jew. So she was proud of Hannah. She said that, that was the message of Hannah to the whole world. And the message of Hannah to Abraham, thank you, Abraham. Look what I did, Abraham Abino. You sacrifice one, I sacrifice 3, 7. It doesn't mean that I am more than you. It is because of you. I match you because you did what you did, the way you dedicated to them. It's hard. That's what I did. So even that I have 7 children, I give them the same education that you and Sarah, you give to its heart. So that's what I did to myself. If the baby, your son, was 44-year-old, mine is only a few years, and even that, he copied your son its heart. Why? The education I gave him. From who I learned this? From you, from Sarah. And I finish with this. One day. So now you understand this is we live the time of Mashiach now. So the time of Mashiach is the time that people are very intelligent, but their brain is a bit, they have a baby brain. They can lose everything. They can lose everything. A baby brain because of the money, because of the thing, yeah, they have everything, a baby. But if you give them a good Jewish education, even And the worst generation that we where we can be, will make it.
That's the question.
Will make it. Now you understand. There were some rabbis. One shul, it was on Rosh Hashanah. They were waiting for the rabbi to go. And at the time they were talking. They were talking about the Mashiach. Why the exile, we're still the exile, Mashiach did not come yet. So everyone said, because maybe we did not do a good teshuva, because maybe this. And each one gave a reason. Okay, each one gave a reason why we still living in this generation. But just to be, the story is short. I want just to tell you what this is. All the time you find people talking about Mashiach. You understand me? Yeah, but that today is we live the generation of people. Why? Even people say, why Mashiach? Every day, every year we say, this year Mashiach is going to come. Every year we say, this year was going to come. I remember my father, Alav Shalom. I remember my father, every day he asked me, David, what do you think? Do you think Mashiach will come today? And I used to ask, I said to my father, Papa, if you did ask me this question, what do you think? I think today is going to come. There is all signs. Then he did not come, of course. But the next day, he asked me again. All the time, I asked him, Papa, what do you think? Every time, his answer was, he was living. That was 30 years ago. He was living that every day Mashiach is going to come. This the same way I feel it as well. Baby, I'm telling you, God, every day I feel Mashiach is going to come. And every day I feel it. Sometimes I even feel, why I have to travel? Why I have to open more yeshivot? Why I think about the future? That Mashiach is going to come. And my answer is, till he did not come, I have to open yeshivot. Till he did not come, I have to carry on my work.
That's right.
Till he comes. Because I have work to do. Because Mashiach is waiting that I will open the 26th yeshivot. Maybe he's waiting for that. So if I stop now, I only have 19. Then you will accuse me. I will tell him, Mashiach, but I thought going to come. My father teach me that everything is going to come. He said, no, every day. Every day. If you finish. You see every day. But for me, I will come the day you finish your 26 issue to be. It's just an example I tell you. Instead of talking when is it going to come, when is it going to come, do something to come. This is my answer. Instead of talking how I'm gonna be rich, work. Get it's like so this like somebody is a rabbi, give me an idea how to work. I know he doesn't work, I know he's lazy man, and you want to be rich. Go to work, wake up. Use the money of your father, use it well, instead of buying drugs, instead of just charging cars. Do something, and you will be rich. Then somebody will ask me. Rabbi David, I want to be rich like X. Give me a good bracha. I told him, that man is rich because his father was rich. And his grandfather was rich. You are poor. Your father was poor. Your grandfather was poor. And you want to be rich. So if you have this ambition to be rich, go to work. Go to work. Pray to Hashem. You can. It's like this man who prayed to every day to Hashem. Hashem, I want to win the lotto. Please, Hashem, I want to be a billionaire. I want to win the lotto. One day, every day to open the Arona Kodesh. Hashem, please, I want to win the lotto. And then one day he heard, did you feel the lotto? Did you feel the lotto? To win the lotto, you have to feel it. People want to win the lotto, they don't feel the lotto. People want to be a tzaddik, they don't do how to be a tzaddik. People, they want Mashiach, but they don't do nothing to be Mashiach. Do lecha. We don't ask you that your children will die for Hashem. No. Do that they will not die spiritually. That's it. No, it's Hashem, this is the show of today. Baruch HaVetzlacha, and we pray to Hashem to resist all the temptation that there is today. Baruch Hashem, we live, Baruch Hashem, this moment to see Mashiach. Amen.